All righty. Okay, we're good to go. So, hi everyone. Before we start off, there's a link at the bottom here. It's also in my Twitter, Senor Huidobro. If you want to follow along the slides on your device, just for convenience sake. My name's Ramón. I'm a freelance software dev, and I teach children to code on the side. I'm from Chile, and I live in Vienna in Austria. And you might be wondering from the website, on the website of the conference, what's with the picture of the dog? Can we see more of the dog, please? Don't worry, I've got you covered. This is Fiona. this is Fiona. We adopted her about three years ago, and I love her so much especially because of her eyes. She has these Simpsons eyes that look in different directions, and she says so much with these eyes. My favorite is this top right photo where she's judging my wife while she eats mango. So in Chilean Spanish, I don't know about other Spanishes, but in Chilean Spanish we have this word to describe Fiona, which is regalona. Now, I haven't been able to find a suitable translation. I tried. I put it into Google Translate, didn't quite work. So I put in regalona, I got regalona back. I tried it in German. In Austria, we speak German, and I thought, well, German has a bajillion words. I'm sure it'll be there. But German being German, it capitalized it. In short, regalona kind of means like spoiled, but you spoil them on purpose and they love you. It's a whole thing. Anyway, let's talk about rhythm video games, in particular dancing video games. Any of you played Just Dance? Yeah. I can't quite see, so I'm going to say from that one yes that all of you do. I haven't myself, but what you do is you dance to the rhythm, you do the little poses, and you get points as you go. So, and this is fairly popular, they're still making them to this day, but when I was a kid, about 20 years ago, there was this other game called Dance Dance Revolution, or DDR. Nice to hear there's a few fans in here. If you're not familiar with DDR, as I'm going to refer to it from now on, what you see is, you can see here in this very well done GIF, is that this person's pressing the buttons to the rhythm of the music. Now on screen, what you see is little arrows that come up as the song goes on to tell you when to step on the buttons, right? And it's a lot of fun. You can see it's a bit older. So this is from PlayStation, I think. It's fairly old, but it's a lot of fun. And the music, how do I put this? I'm gonna show you. Let me just load it up here. It's something else. By the way, whoever was in charge of the playlist of music today, you're really nailing it. So I used to play this a lot when I was a kid, but a few years ago, I introduced this game to my wife, who had never played it before. And so we were looking for ways to play it. And we actually found an open source alternative called Stepmania. Anybody heard of Stepmania? Ooh, I see a couple of hands, cool. So Stepmania lets you load in your own songs and customize it to your liking. And what's cool is, as I said, it's fully open source. So okay, we had the software, we had the music, what about the controller, you might be wondering. So in the arcade, the controllers for Dance Dance Revolution were these big metallic ones, but at home, what you had, especially during the heyday of DDR, were these foam mats. They looked like this. And they were great, they were affordable, they were about 30 euros, so $30 approximately. And they were a lot of fun, but the problem is that if you use them as much as we did, they kind of wore out after a while. And so you started getting used to seeing this screen a lot. So you couldn't really press the buttons anymore. So we looked into metal alternatives. And they do exist, you can buy them. But I don't know if you saw the price, but it's like, for two of them, that's $300. And that's discounted from $900. That's a lot of bones for, wanting to play some DDR. So we didn't really look into it, but then a few years later, my wife and I were at this thing called Maker Faire. Do they have that here?
Yeah.
Yeah? Cool. So we were at the Maker Faire in Vienna, and I was introduced to something called Bare Conductive Paint. Anybody heard of this?
Yeah.
Oh my God, it's cool. So what this is here is, so when I learned about Bare Conductive Paint on like those random Facebook videos you scroll through, is that it allows you to draw circuits using paint. So they had a demo where you could like draw lines from a battery to a light bulb and create your own little circuit, and it worked, which was pretty cool. But what you can see here is that it's also capacitative, which means that if you touch it, it induces a charge that can be sent to a receptor. In this case, a cap that you put on top of a Raspberry Pi. So this demo here allowed you to play a little piano using a Raspberry Pi and some paint, which I thought was cool. And then I thought, I could do something with this. So I did some research at home, and I saw that they have a Node.js interface that you can install on the Raspberry Pi that even had a nice little code example. That was very handy. And then I thought, I could definitely make something with this. And then I went back to Stepmania and I saw I can customize all the controls. And then I thought, so what if we take a Raspberry Pi, some of the paint, a yoga mat, some Node.js? Lo and behold, Project Dancemat was born. Something to bear in mind, though, is that this is the first time I had ever worked with anything hardware related. So needless to say, I was a little intimidated. But I still went for it. So OK, we sat down, my wife and I, and we thought, OK, what are we going to make out of this? How's it going to work? Very simple. We'll have a dance mat that you connect to a computer, and the computer thinks, aha, this is a keyboard. And then it'll handle the button presses as if they were keyboard strokes. Fantastic. So I had my little bit of setting up here. They have this NPM package that I could install, set the thresholds for touching and releasing, that is how sensitive, because when something is capacitative, it also detects when your finger is like approaching the paint. So you wanna mess around with the sensitivity. So great, so we had everything set up except for that big comment that says, send data to PC, which, I like to jump into projects without doing much research, so I learned that Raspberry Pis, when you plug them into a computer, the computer doesn't automatically go, oh, this is a USB device, I can take it from here. Now you might be thinking, Ramon, did you not research this? And let me remind you, this is my first time doing a project like this. But okay, I did some searching around, I talked to some friends, and I discovered that you can configure what's called a gadget. You see, a Raspberry Pi, the most common software used on it is Linux. So I could configure this Linux kernel to have a little Raspberry, when you connect it to a PC, tell it, haha, I'm a USB keyboard device. And I found a blog post that let me do all the copy-pasting, which is fantastic. So I just took the copy-pasting part. I took the most important part, which is, of course, the serial number, the manufacturer and product. Don't worry about what this does. What it does in short is basically set it up so that when this is a script that, when run, will set itself up as a recognizable USB device for the computer to interact with. So then, okay, that's one part done. Then I need to actually send data through that USB interface. So I went on the USB human interface devices documentation, and I downloaded what I found out was a 96-page PDF. And I made the sound that a basset hound makes when it barks. You're like, oof. But I stuck with it. And I found out that, in short, to interact with this USB interface, I need to send a byte array of 8 hexadecimal keys, right? And so a keys is a hex code. And I need to send a byte array of 8 of these. That's cool. I did some searching around, and I found a nice GitHub listing of all of the keys. Very cool. And so I define my little constants for left, right, up, and down. And I set these up so that when the when they're pressed by me, the Raspberry Pi would tell the computer A, B, C, and D. This was so exciting. Just to write this code. So that got me started. So I defined these constants, and then I told myself, all right, now we'll process the actual touches. First, I'll get the keys that are sent to the that are sent from the cap connected to the Raspberry Pi to this function, which is an array of electrodes that are pressed. So what I would do is have would parse those pressed keys from the data, and then take those and make a an array of 8 keys. Now you might be wondering, what if you're just pressing one? Well, then you just have one press key and 8 blank ones. Okay, so to parse those keys, all I needed to do was loop through each of the electrodes that are pressed, and depending on which index it has, because you probably saw in the picture, I should have one here. You probably saw that it had 12 or so electrodes that you could touch. So from left to right, I just assigned them accordingly, and then I was all set. I could return my pressed keys. Next up, to actually turn that into an array of keys and turn that into a keystroke, I would just force it to be 8 in any case and fill the rest with blank ones. Please stop me if I'm going too fast. So with that, with this program running, I could have it always detect which ones are pressed, and it would just log out the keystroke as it would be. And of course, if there's more than one pressed, then it would take both into account. Because in DDR, I don't know if you know, there are times when you have to press 2, like this, like that. I'm not going to do much more of that. So now we'll actually send. Now we'll actually take the byte array out of that. Turns out there's a JavaScript function for getting a 8-bit unsigned integers. So you could just call uint8array from keystroke. All set, all nice. And now to send this keystroke to the actual USB interface. I hadn't done this before. So I did some research, and I found out that the actual interface in Linux is interacted by something called a file descriptor. So what a file descriptor is, I'm just going to take my cursor out of there. Somebody should have said something. What a file descriptor is that any communication that Linux does is through with other devices, with any input-output devices, is through files. So a USB device, a computer, a node on a network, or even a Word document, those are all files to Linux, so that you can send and get data from them. So I thought, I wonder if there's anything on NPM that does this. Lo and behold, there is. I found this Linux device package, which let me just open up that USB interface. And all I had to do was call device write buffer, and I was good to go. Now, you might be wondering, did it work? And I said, well, before we get there, we have to be responsible. When the program ends, I need to close that device. Did it work? Well, let's find out. So I ran Node dance-mat.js. I plugged the Raspberry Pi into my laptop. I opened up a text editor, best type of testing there is. And look at that. I'm sending A, B, and C. I have never been so excited to see these letters. Now, you might be wondering, Ramon, why did you show us every sordid detail of that? And I just wanted to share my excitement that, you know, I didn't have any experience doing this, and I got stuck, and it sucked a bit. But in the end, I persevered. My wife was very patient with me, and it worked. And then came the fun part. We could actually start painting. And so this is pictures from home. We took the paint. We bought a yoga mat at the corner store. We even made it two-player compatible. And after a while, we cut them up because we found out that dancing so close to each other can cause a few problems. And did it work? Yes. Did we start passing songs with super scores? You know, we got D's, but I mean, it had been a while since we played. So then the question was, are we set for life now? And really, it depends on how you look at it. So here's something I learned. Putting paint on a yoga mat and expecting that to stay forever, yeah. So then, you know, we had to reapply some coats of paint. We have to modify some things here and there. And we started gathering what we called a if I could do it all over again list. When talking about this to friends, they said, Ramón, why didn't you use an Arduino? And I'm like, what is an Arduino? We found out, yes, it's nice to be able to roll up the yoga mat, but maybe a more flat surface would be good for the paint. And we started, and you know, we also thought about maybe for latency to have physical cables instead of paint. And you know, we started doing some mods like that. I don't solder myself, but my wife, she knows how to do it, and she does it very well. And you might be thinking, so do you feel like you did it? And I'm like, yes, of course, because the important thing is we learned a lot, and we are delighted about it. This picture's from 3 days ago. So I've got a few takeaways for you. I mean, like, you know, if you're not experienced in messing around with hardware, it can look super daunting, and you might want to have a fire extinguisher close by. But the importance of playing around with stuff is so vital, and it's so much fun, and you learn so much. And here's the important part. If you have an idea, just go for it. You never know if it's going to work. Thanks, folks.